looking at Wales, the process of devolution, and what Brexit may mean constitutionally for the United Kingdom. Now, as we've heard, over the last two decades, we've been witnessing this ongoing process of devolution. It's a process, not an event. This process where Scotland, Wales, and Northern Ireland now have their own governments, their own elected assemblies, and their own lawmaking powers in devolved areas like health, education, and also heavily Europeanized areas such as agriculture, fisheries, and the environment. As we've heard, devolution has been asymmetric. There is not one model of devolution for the United Kingdom. The powers that each of the devolved administrations hold are different. The way that those powers are transferred is different. For example, Wales has had, up until now, a conferred model of power. So it has, under the Government of Wales Act, listed their powers, policy areas that are explicitly given to Wales to act within. Schedule 7 lists a range of policy areas, specific issues, that Wales can legislate on. Scotland and Northern Ireland have a different model, a reserved powers model. They can do everything that hasn't been explicitly reserved. So even at that level, we have different approaches in that this constitutional structure of devolution. Devolution, as we said, this ongoing process, it's in an almost continual state of flux, not only with the Supreme Court decisions that may reinterpret the underpinning legislation, but also that legislation itself. We're currently having a debate about another iteration of the Government of Wales Bill. So we have a Wales, so Government of Wales Act, we have a Wales Bill that is almost about to receive royal assent, but it has had a very, very bumpy process through the lawmaking channels. Now, part of what this Wales Bill will do is move Wales to the reserved powers model and away from the model that we've had over the past decade or so. Now, in these processes, there is perhaps an assumption that devolution will continue in a fairly linear fashion along a road to further and deeper devolution. Now, perhaps, but Brexit is going to challenge that. And we're seeing around the Brexit process, around the referendum, around the negotiation, and then whatever happens post-Brexit, some very stark attempts to recentralize political power, and to re-centralise, sort of reassert a UK sovereignty centred on Westminster and Whitehall, and a reassertion that may inhibit continued devolution with consequences for the future of the UK state. Now, back in June, and unlike Scotland and Northern Ireland, a majority of voters in Wales voted to leave the European Union. And that could have been seen as something of a surprise, because after all, Wales is, and has been for a number of years now, a net beneficiary of EU funding. The UK overall may pay in more than it receives out, but for Wales, that is different. Structural funds, we heard, regional economic development, agricultural funding is absolutely significant, very key to Wales' interests. But public opinion in Wales was closer to that in England on issues such as immigration, and despite Wales having some of the lowest levels of immigration in the UK. Now, Wales voted to leave, or a majority of the voters voted to leave, which put the voting public out of step with the Welsh political establishment, which, apart from 7 UKIP Assembly members who were elected for the first time back in the May elections to the Welsh Assembly, the majority of the Assembly members in the Welsh Assembly are very much pro-European and see Wales's future within the European Union, or at least within the single market. Now, of course, in her speech on Tuesday, Mrs. May stressed that the UK will be out of the single market. And she certainly didn't foresee any differentiated model, any situation where parts of the UK could be in and other parts of the UK out of this single market. She's been clear, the Prime Minister has been clear as well throughout this process that the negotiations will be led on a whole UK union basis. There will be fairly limited opportunities for the devolved administrations to feed into those negotiations. And there's definitely, as far as London is concerned, no role foreseen for them to have any sort of veto only over any of the deals that may be done. Though we know that from within the devolved nations, from Scotland, and also from within Wales, there are calls for the parliaments and the assemblies to have some say, to have some vote on the final deal, in the same way as we now know the UK Parliament will have a vote. Now, in terms of what Brexit may mean for Wales, of course, Wales may be a loser in terms of the respect of the funding that it previously received, which may not be replaced by the Treasury. It's confirmed that it will support that funding up until 2020, but there's no commitment beyond that. So whilst it may be a loser in those terms, it may be a winner in terms of new powers that may come to it. And Michael has highlighted some of these already. Because the ongoing process of devolution, the devolution of powers away from London to Cardiff to Edinburgh and to Belfast, has to date taken place within the context of the UK's membership of the EU. And EU law has set important parameters around how the devolved nations exercise their powers. And that limits the degree to which law across the UK can diverge. So in those areas which have been devolved but are also Europeanised, such as agriculture, environment and fisheries, the devolved nations are essentially implementing decisions taken elsewhere. Now, according to the current devolution legislation, once the UK leaves, those powers go to the devolved. And they will now have the scope to exercise those in a more independent and autonomous way than before. So Wales may get new powers, and it may be able to develop its own policies in a way that it hasn't been able to before. But that said, unless it also gets the financial resources to run them, it's not going to be much of a win. Alternatively, these powers may not go to Wales at all, but they may be taken back to Westminster. They may be re-centralised. The Prime Minister's speech on Tuesday touched on the issue of the repatriation of powers. And she mentioned needing to ensure that the right powers are returned to Westminster, with the right powers returned or passed on to the devolved administrations of Scotland, Wales, and Northern Ireland. And in that, perhaps there is at least an acknowledgement that powers won't necessarily automatically return to Westminster. But she did say that there would be no new barriers to living and doing business within the UK's union. Now, one of the consequences of EU membership is that the requirements set at an EU level to ensure that there is the free movement of goods and the free movement of workers and the free movement of services apply to regulators within the UK. And it applies to them in Scotland, Wales, England, and Northern Ireland. So they minimise those opportunities for divergence that could emerge. So the UK's own economic union, its own internal market, is sustained by the EU's internal market and its rules on free movement. Take that EU framework away, and the exercise of devolved powers across the UK may result in a patchwork of regulatory responses that could make trade across the UK more burdensome and more costly than it perhaps needs to be. And so we might need a reassertion, some statement about some new principles to underpin the UK union, something like an economic union principle, an internal market for the United Kingdom. But we'd also need to create the machinery to create and police that. How much that may constrain the exercise of repatriated devolved powers remains to be seen. And there's certainly concerns in Wales that Brexit will have a retrograde consequence for the scope of Wales's devolved powers and that continuation of the devolution process. And those concerns were central this week in motivating a majority of Welsh Assembly members to support the new UK Parliament's Wales Bill. Though it's also seen as being inadequate, an imperfect settlement, it moves to the reserved powers model, but it introduces nearly 200 reservations, and there seems to be, there doesn't seem to be a very clear sort of rationale or principled underpinning for where these reservations have come from. It also rolls back some existing powers that Wales has been able to develop for itself in relation to employment law, for example. But one of the things it does do is, as Michael's highlighted, it introduces into statutory form the Sewell Convention, this convention that in areas that relate to devolved matters, the UK Parliament will not normally legislate unless it has the consent of the devolved administration, devolved assembly. And that's placed on a statutory basis. And the Labour AMs, the majority party, the government party in Wales at the moment, their support for the Wales Bill was on the basis that that provides some sort of protection against possible repatriation and re-centralisation of powers on Brexit. Plaid Cymru, the party of Wales, did not support the Wales Bill. They say that it's a retrograde step as far as devolution is concerned. And UKIP also did not support the bill on the basis that it creates new income tax powers for Wales that it says should only be granted after a referendum. So there was a majority view, but there was definitely sort of split across the parties. Now, next week we'll hear from the Supreme Court in Miller, where the central question we know is whether the Parliament or the government gets to trigger Article 50. But devolution issues are present in this case, and it's possible, although it's unlikely, that in addition to saying that an Act of Parliament may be necessary, the Supreme Court may also say that Sewell is engaged, that this is, the Act of Parliament is needed, a piece of legislation is needed, that impacts on devolved matters, and so the devolved assemblies also have to have a say. Now, Scotland and Northern Ireland, some voices in Northern Ireland have called for that. Wales hasn't. Wales also intervened, but they said, they didn't call for the vote. What they said is, you will be changing our powers by doing this. You will be changing the scope of our competences by taking us out of the European Union. You shouldn't be able to do that by royal prerogative. You should only be doing that through an Act of Parliament. So Wales's intervention was to support the Parliament's position rather than to call for the Welsh Parliament and the Welsh Government to have a say in that way. But we'll find out next week where this takes us. Now, from the perspective of devolution and the future of our constitution, it may be that the court comes up with a radical, robust reading of the devolution settlements that give these powers to the devolved. But that's probably quite unlikely. But we may see a more sort of traditional, conventional view of the UK's constitution, and one that may be legally correct, but one which may not be perceived as sort of legitimate as far as the devolved administrations and their experiences may see it.